this morning is Sola Scriptura, How to Interpret Prophecy. It's an extremely important subject because there is a great confusion among Christians in this world about prophecy, and maybe even among the Last Day Church. And so therefore we need all the help we can get, and let us ask the Lord to help us. Heavenly Father, thank you for the opportunity of sharing this truth, and may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our Savior and Redeemer. Amen. Amen. And so I'd like to introduce you to a concept that has inspired me during much of my life, and that is the heritage of Bible prophecy. Here is a statement that says, God's workers today constitute the connecting link between the former workers, the church of history, and the church that is to be called out from the world and prepared to meet the Lord. From age to age, the light which God has for the world has been imparted to the church militant. All the excellencies that have come through the belief of the truth from past generations to the present time are to be treated with the utmost respect. This was written by Ellen White in Special Testimony, Series A, number 7, in 1897, page 11. Now look at this statement. What is so unique? What strikes you? We today are between the workers in the past, God's church in the past, and the church that is to be called out from the world, which indicates that this message of prophecy is for the world, right? And so furthermore, it says from age to age, the light which God has for the world has been imparted to the church militant. So what does it mean that God has given light to the early church, to the dark or middle ages, to the Reformation, post-Reformation, and today? And so it's very important to keep it in mind, because if we have to share the light of God to the world, we have to know, what did God give to the early church? What did he give to the Dark Ages? What to the Reformation? Because we are not just sharing only the last days. What has God given us and has accumulated throughout the centuries and that need to be given? And so God's light on prophetic history through the Christian history, light on the early Christians, God's light on the Middle Ages, God's light on the Protestant Reformation, God's light on the post-Reformation era, and God's light today. However, very few people know this light. And so therefore, our message to the world is not as effective as it should be. And so what now about prophecy among the early Christians? Signs before Christ's return. What does the Bible say? The Apostle Paul in 2 Thessalonians, the second chapter, verse 1 to 8. If you read this very carefully, you see here a shocking revelation. Christians expect already the Lord to have come. Did he come? No, Paul says no, he will not come. In fact, the conclusion of the section is, before the second advent, there will be an apostasy by a power called the men of sin, or lawlessness. Now, if you ask Christians around you, when will the man of sin come? Many will say, okay, in the near future. Very, very soon. He's around the corner. What did Paul tell us? Because if you think that the man of sin will come in the future, you are deceived. When will the man of sin appear? 2 Thessalonians verse 6 through 8. You know what is restraining, that he may be revealed in his own time. For the mystery of lawlessness and iniquity is already at work. Only he who now restrains will so do until he's taken out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will consume with the breath of his mouth and destroy with the brightness of his coming. This is the New King James. And so what do we see here? There is a restraining power. And only when this restraining power is out of the way, he will come. Hey, when will this power come? Paul says, he is already in my day. You see that? And so, but there is a restraining power at the time that will prevent this power to come. How long will this power continue? The end of the man of sin. When? The Lord will consume him in the breath of his mouth. When will that be? At the second advent. So here is a power operating in Paul's day. It's a restraining power now. It will be taken out of the way. And then he will come and last until Jesus comes. So now we have to look around in the history of Christianity and say, when did that power come? What did the early Christians think about? They identified the man of sin as the future Antichrist. What is an Antichrist? He is a person who opposes God. And not only that, but he acts in the place of God. He thinks he is God. He was also, by the early Christians, associated with the little horn of Daniel 7, or the harlot of Revelation 17. He will persecute God's people for 3.5 times or years. And the identity of the restraining power to the early Christians, it was the Roman Empire. And as long as the Roman Empire was there, nothing to fear. And so Tertullian, one of the early church fathers, said, let us pray that the Roman Empire will continue. It's a terrible power. But it gets worse in the future. It gets much worse. So let's pray for the Roman Empire. The time of the man of sin has full authority over the church after the fall of the Roman Empire for 1260 days. That is what the early Christians thought. They had also a view about Daniel 7. It was the expectation of the early Christians about the four beasts of Daniel 7. Remember, they are the lion, the bear, what else? The leopard, the dragon-like beast. They were all there. And they were interpreted by the early Christians as Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. Rome would be divided into 10 kingdoms. And afterwards, the little horn power, the Antichrist, will arise, uproot 3 kingdoms, and last till the end of the world. The little horn power would dominate God's people for a time, times and a half a time, or 3.5 times or years. It would think to change times and law. So this is clearly the Antichrist, according to the early Christians. And again, we will see in history what took place. Now let us now look at history. The rise of the man of sin. The very early church, the religion was pure, but soon things came to change. The nature of the apostasy and the persecution. In the 4th century, the Emperor Constantine favored the Catholic body of Christians, which became the most powerful group of Christians. He had many factions of Christians. But the politician, Constantine, was needing support. He saw that the Christians were persecuted, slaughtered. But no matter how many were slaughtered, things went worse for the empire. And so he said, you know, I should put my faith into the Christian area, the Catholics. So 2 centuries later, you get then Catholicism becoming a religion of a unity between church and state. The Emperor Justinian I made the Pope the head of all the churches of Christendom and the corrector of heretics. Now, if you are the corrector of heretics, what does that indicate? That you know the truth. Because otherwise you can't correct heretics. And so the Pope took a tremendous power and position. Then Catholicism left the faith of Jesus, and salvation is obtained now through works. You work your way through. And of course, the clergy. So the system of Catholicism is hierarchical. It is the Pope, the bishops, the priests, and that affects the rest of the people. They controlled the people there. And so therefore Catholicism developed. The idea of the unity of church and state led to an expansion of Catholicism by armies. So that is what you see here. If you believe that, you can use the state to further your ends. And so a growing persecution of anyone who questions the Catholic Church. Now, in the beginning, it was mild, but it gets worse and worse and worse. And of course, sooner or later, you get a reaction. What is the reaction? A rise of protest during the Middle Ages, especially the Waldenses and the Albigenses. And friends, they protested very strongly. What did they protest against? Protest against the Roman Catholic Church disregard of the Bible teaching and the practice that had great impact until the Inquisition. And crusades were organized against those people. And in fact, you know, there was a total genocide of the Albigenses. Terrible, terrible, terrible. Now you can go there and you see only ruins of places where they lived. It's now a tourist attraction. Ah, you want to have the Albigenses, the Cathars? They lived here and they lived there. And they made money out of the slaughter. Terrible, terrible, terrible. What was so terrible with the Waldenses and the Albigenses? Because they identified the little horn as a system. Not anymore as a person, no, as a system. The papacy. And similarly, the papacy was identified as the man of sin, Babylon, and the Antichrist. Here is the picture. You see one of the schools of the barbs. Every year I go with a tour and show people there how they were educated by the barbs. Their uncles, their missionaries. What are the views of the Waldenses that made them so terrible? The Roman Church is the harlot, the Babylon of Revelation. It is the Antichrist sitting in God's temple, the church. You know, in the New Testament, Paul talks lots about God's temple, the temple. But the temple is really the word for the church. The attack, the truth, and the saints. And they felt that the Pope is the head and originator of all heresies. The preaching authority is from God, they said, not from Bishop and Paul. Now, why did they say that? Because you had to get permission of the Pope or the bishops in order to preach. So there was a delegation of the Waldenses that went to Rome at the Third Lateran Council, and they requested this. They were interviewed, and as a result of their answers, they were denied. Of course, the Waldenses didn't like it, and they continued to preach anyway. And that, of course, caused a tremendous persecution. And therefore they said, it is from God. We don't have to ask you what we should do. God's elect, they said, is still in Babylon. There are still good Catholic people who are deceived. They said, we have to call them out of Babylon. come out of her, my people. And so the Waldenses consider themselves as the true representatives of the people, of the apostles. It is not the apostolic succession of the Catholic Church. No, it is the faith and teaching of the apostles that you can see in the lives of the Waldenses. What do you say? Amen. That is what God's church in the last day should have also. Now, in the terrible slaughter of the Middle Ages, darkness, darkness, darkness. The Protestants called it the Dark Ages. Now today we use it the Middle Ages because of the influence of Catholic scholarship. But in spite of the darkness, God gave light. God never leaves his people. Even if everybody was under the umbrella of Catholicism. And now prophetic views since the 12th century. The prophetic time is not literal, but symbolic, according to the Roman Catholic abbot Joachim of Florus. You know, the prophecies of Daniel, Revelation that were used are all in symbolic language. You see beasts with 10 horns, beast with 4 heads. You know, you don't see it today. You've never seen it. So therefore, there are symbols. But the early Christians took the time literal. Now we are here more than 1,000 years, more than 1,200 years. And Joachim said, hey, you know, if the pictures are symbolic, why not be consistent and take the time symbolic? And that's what he did. Then he applied the Yireh principle in Numbers 14 and Ezekiel 4 to the time prophecies about Antichrist in Daniel and Revelation. That's what he did. And the context is that after many centuries, we are now here 12 centuries, Rome had now taken on the characteristics of the Antichrist in Bible prophecy. The characteristics of the Antichrist in Bible prophecy was now seen in that terrible monster of Catholicism during the Middle Ages. Developments of time prophecy in the Middle Ages. And so here then, what was the impact of Joachim of Fiore since the 12th century? Prophetic time is now seen by the followers of Joachim as symbolic. And so they use the Yireh principle in Numbers 14:34 and Ezekiel 4:6. They applied it to Daniel Revelation. And so there's 3.5 times or years, or the 42 months, or the 1260 days equals now 1260 actual years. You see, God is so concerned about us that not only one, twice, but 7 times. 2 times in the book of Daniel, 5 times in the book of Revelation, he gives warning to God's people and to the world. And this is a message that needs to be shared with the world. And so, then Joachim started and said, you know, the 1260 years, let us now start with Christ's birth. And so you add 1260 years to his birth, and you come to 1260. Because after this period, there would be a deadly wound, a terrible blow to Catholicism, and maybe it would be eradicated. What happened in 1260? Nothing. So when nothing happened, the followers took another day. It says, maybe we should start the time prophecy with Christ's death, 31 AD or 33 AD. They added it, and then they came to 1291. What do we see there? Nothing. No blow to Catholicism. So then he said, maybe we should start with another catastrophe in the early church, the fall of Jerusalem, the terrible slaughter there, that is in the year 70. So let us now add 1260, and then we come to 1330, 30-30, what is that? We are now in the time of Wycliffe, the reformer, but no blow against Catholicism. In fact, when Wycliffe died, they exhumed his body and burned his bones. That was the hatred that Catholicism had. So, further light on the little horn. Now the little horn was identified. The context, that is the power struggle between Pope Gregory IX and Emperor Frederick II. They both accused each other, but the beast of the bottomless pit, or the Antichrist. And so the emperor organized a synod of Catholics who supported him in Regensburg, Germany in 1240. And there, the Archbishop of Salzburg, Eberhard II, came to the help of the emperor, and he said, "New insights in the study of prophecy. The Pope is the little horn of Daniel 7. Wow. Of course, many people rejected it, but others say, no, he's right. And the key issue is now here, did Rome fall in the time of the early church that led to the rise of the little horn? You see, Daniel 7 is very important. Daniel 7, you see there, the fourth beast is Rome. And then out of this beast, you have 10 horns. And then a little horn comes up, uproots three. And so it was understood then that sooner or later, the Roman Empire would fall and would be divided into 10 kingdoms. Then the little horn would come, three would be uprooted, and this little horn would go to the time of the end. The question is now, when did Rome fall? It's a very important question. And so here now, the 13th century evidence became clear that Rome had fallen. Archbishop Eberhard's contribution. Historical facts confirmed that Rome had fallen and was divided into 10 kingdoms. In fact, if you go to Jerome, he writes about the fall of Rome, and he identifies 10 tribes, and then later on in 10 kingdoms, and go on and on and on. And in the Reformation, it is clear that Rome had fallen. The rise of the little horn fits the history of papacy. So Bible and history were compared. The nature of the little horn reveals the nature of the papacy. Eberhard's impact was tremendous because people studied this, and the papacy as the little horn of Daniel 7 becomes the standard view among whom? John Wycliffe and his followers in Britain, Luther and his associates in Germany, Cranmer and Knox and the majority of British reformers, and the majority of the 17th and 18th century Protestants. In fact, you know, frequently you hear now, you know, the difference between Luther and the Catholics, it was a misunderstanding because we have now solved it. We both believe in justification by faith only. That's only half of the equation. Luther, of his understanding, saw that the papacy is a little horn, and therefore, as is the Antichrist and had, should not be followed at all. And so Luther, because of his view of prophecy, denounced the Pope, was excommunicated, and left the Catholic Church because of his view of prophecy. You see, his confession, Father Staupitz says, Luther, about justification by faith and righteousness, I believe it so. Keep your mouth. Don't attack the Pope. And Luther looks over the masses. We're all deceived. And he could not keep quiet. And today, friends, over 1 billion Catholics are still deceived. Are we moved with compassion? Or are we thinking, oh yeah, you know, that is there for you? No. If we have the love of Christ, we will reach out to our Catholic friends, to rescue them. And so, why did it took so long? Of that is the speed of progressive revelation. Why did it take so many centuries before interpreters identified the papacy and prophecy? The perception of Rome as the eternal city. Now, if you believe that Rome is eternal, you don't think about the fall of Rome, right? Then secondly, the anticipation of the end of the world. The early Christians believed that it would be soon. Not that you have to wait at least 1,000 years or more. So therefore, you didn't think about symbolic time. The popular belief of the Antichrist is a person, and it is 1260 days. So all of that mitigates against the symbolic view. Augustinian view of the millennium, and Augustine believed that the millennium started with Christ coming, and would last, and it doesn't matter whether it is 1,000 years, whether it is shorter or longer. You call this view amillennialism. And so that mitigated against it. And then the proper fulfillment needed time to mature. The papacy in the early church or in the Reformation, totally day and night difference. And so the view of many Protestant reformers, what was it? The identity of the restraining power of 2 Thessalonians, the reformers were now clear. It was the restraining power is the Roman Empire, like the early Christians believed. Then the fall of Rome and the papacy took its place. The little horn came afterwards. And then they continued. The mystery of the man of sin, the identification of the man of sin is as the Antichrist. The rise of the apostate church, the papacy. New insight in prophetic times. And they is 1 year. And the papacy was to rule for 3.5 years, or 42 months, or 1260 days, or 1260 years. Now here you see the coat of arms. And this same coat of arms is still there under Francis. It's two keys. He is ruler over the church, spiritual realm, and over the secular realm. If you go to the top of St. Peter, you look down, you see beautifully in flowers the same coat of arms. Of course, he has not the power of secular power, but still it continues. The papacy is the little horn of Daniel 7, who persecute God's people for 3.5 prophetic years or 1260 years. In Revelation 12, this comes also up. Satan persecute God's people for 1260 prophetic days or 1260 years. Revelation 13, Satan's instrument is the first or sixth sea beast of Revelation 13. It is the papacy that persecute God's people for 42 prophetic months or 1260 years. That's all what the Protestant believed. The papacy is the harlot of Revelation 17. So now, let us now look here more carefully on Daniel 7. The rise of the little horn is the man of sin. The four beasts are the four world empires of Babylon, Medo Persia, Greece, and Rome. Today, many Protestants don't even know this simple thing. Then Rome would fall, divided into 10 kingdoms. Then the little horn would rise up, uproot 3 of the 10 kingdoms, and is of a different nature than all the other 10. Now, this is interesting, you know, because today there are people in Europe that can identify themselves with the Anglo-Saxons, the Alamanni, the Germans, the Suevi, the Portuguese, the Visigoths, Spain, the Burgundians, you know. But nobody today can identify themselves with the Heruli, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. Those three are completely wiped up. How? Through the influence of the papacy. Calling upon the emperor, and those three were eliminated. Exactly. Every year when I go on my tours, I show people the remnants, the only remnant in the world, the Ostrogoths, and you still find buildings. That's still a reminder of the fulfillment of the prophecy. It's a blasphemous power. Persecute God's people for time and a half a time. 3.5 prophetic years, which is 1260 years. What about Revelation 12, the dragon and the woman? You know the struggle there. The war between the woman and the dragon. Satan, working through the Roman Empire, attacks God's people and try to destroy the child, remember? But Christ escaped to heaven. And now Satan continues to persecute the woman. And the woman fleds in the wilderness for 1,200 prophetic days or 1,260 years. Again, you see this. After this time, Satan launches an attack on the remnant of God's people, which are faithful. You know, the last text in the chapter says, you know, Satan is angry because in spite of the persecutions, God's people are still there, a remnant. And what is the characteristic of the remnant? They keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus. The prophetic testimony is still there. They are people that are obedient in every way. Keep the Ten Commandments. And at the same time, what do? They have the prophetic word. And so, the reformers and the sea beast of Revelation 13, the rise of the beast of Revelation 13. The beast arises out of the sea, composed of elements of the empire of Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, and Rome. Then the dragon gives the beast his power, throne, and authority for 42 prophetic months or 1260 years. This is all that the reformers believed. And there would be, what was the throne that Satan gave? The throne of paganism in the time of Christ was Rome, the city of apostasy, the city of idolatry. That city was given and became the headquarters of Catholicism today. Gave him his power, his authority. He is the vicar of Christ. And then the beast was worshipped, blasphemed. It was one blasphemous power. And one of his heads was mortally wounded and was healed. And the whole world wondered after the beast. Where do you find any great leader today, Christian leader, religious leader, that has the power to address both houses of Congress, the United Nations, and have a tremendous impact on the climate control and whatever? The Pope. Catholicism has its function on every committee of the United Nations and on every committee of the World Council of Churches, even if they are not even a member of the World Council of Churches. And so, what was the heritage of Protestant Christianity? The views of the little horn ruled during the Reformation. So people are still now trying to find out, when does this deadly wound come on the papacy? Here are the reformers. And so the reformers looked in history and they said, you know, the apostasy really began with Constantine. When Constantine came and associated with the early Christians, paganism came into the church. And so that is what they said. So in 312, that was the Peace of Milan, let us start there. And from 312, and we add 1260, we come to 1572. Now, what happened in 1572? A black day for Catholicism? No, for Protestantism. It was St. Bartholomew Massacre. 70,000 Protestants were eliminated in the course of several weeks in France. The Pope coined a medal and has a mass to celebrate this victory of Catholicism over the heretics, the Protestants. So when nothing happens, they said maybe we should start with Pope Leo I, who in 440 proclaimed himself the ruler of the world, I am the Caesar. So they add then 440 to 1260, and that is 1700. Was that a blow to Catholicism? No. So then they said, perhaps we should start with Justinian in the 530, because he made the Pope the head of all the churches. And that statement was incorporated in the Codex Justinianus, which is basically the law of the Roman Empire all throughout the Middle Ages until Napoleon and the French Revolution. And so that is what they were looking at. And so 1230s plus 1260s, you come then in the 1790s. Now what happens in the 1790s? The French Revolution, an atheistic power, and it had a tremendous axe to grind with Catholicism. It considered Catholicism as the enemy of the Republic and needed to be eradicated. The Bible says God sometimes uses the wrath of the wicked to accomplish a goal. And so the French Revolution was now used by the Pope, by God, to bring a deadly wound to the Pope. Here are the views of Protestants after the Reformation. The persecuting power of the little horn, the Antichrist in Daniel 7, is the same as the sea beast, Revelation 13, is then bringing the deadly wound. So the papacy dominated God's people during this period of time, during the 1260 prophetic days, which equals 1260 years. And then it will receive a deadly wound or be judged. And this was fulfilled with the captivity of the Pope in 1798, exactly 1260 years after 538. Friends, here it is. Finally, from the 1200s, people have tried to find out when this prophecy is being fulfilled. And it was not until the 18th century and the French Revolution that this element of the prophecy of Daniel 7 was fulfilled. Now, clearly, it was demonstrated without a shadow of a doubt that the papacy is the Antichrist of history. And so this is the situation. Now, where did the Protestant reformers get this information? What was their source? The Bible, also prophecy studied in the light of history, prophetic history. Now, sometimes people tell me, yeah, but I looked in some of the modern history books and they don't find it. You won't find it. You have to take a book that deals with prophetic history, not political history, not economical history, not sociological history, all nice books. But this event is a non-event. In fact, you can look at all the history books today, and the captivity of the Pope is not even mentioned, because they have a different perspective. Study of Daniel and Revelation. All those things need to be taken in consideration. So the Roman Catholic Church now didn't like it and launches a counter-revolution, a counter-reformation. The strategy to do what? To eliminate Protestantism. The formation of the Jesuit order. Here you see Ignatius de Loyola. And if you go into St. Peter, you see a marble statue with his Christian lessons, his Christian exercises, and his foot is on the head of the heretics, the Protestants. Even today, it is there because you cannot eliminate the marble. It's there. And so they developed a counter-interpretation of prophecy, to eliminate the papacy out of prophecy. The focus is on the attack, the Yire principle. And today also, the Yire principle is the focus of attack of anybody who doesn't like the historical view of prophecy. It's not biblical, they say. You cannot find this expressed in Daniel and Revelation. And that is right. It comes from Numbers and Ezekiel. But in prophecy, you take the whole Bible, not only a little bit. Then it is against the ancient traditions of the church. And of course, the early Christians couldn't see 1,000 years ahead. And then it is unreliable. Look at the calculations. One says this, one says that, one says that, whatever. So it cannot be. But remember, the reformers were dealing with unfulfilled prophecy. It was still in the future. So maybe it is this, maybe it is that, maybe it's that. And only when prophecy is fulfilled, you know its fulfillment. So, again, that was used and as an attack against the Protestants. The methods, the interpretation of the two conflicting approaches divert the identification of the Antichrist with the papacy. So what you get now is by the Jesuits, the theory of the futurism and preterism in prophecy. And what is now the contrary interpretations? The rise of modern futurism. Franciscus de Ribera, 1537 to 1591. And he identified the Antichrist in Daniel. That was his focus. And the sources were the early church fathers, because they are the closest to Christ. They should know the truth. And so the view, the Antichrist is a person, not a system, with rules, the final 7 years of the world, the final years, the 7 years of Daniel chapter 9, dispensationalism. Then you have Cardinal Bellarmine, 1542 to 1621. And he then says, no, the fall of Rome, it takes place in the future. Rome is not yet divided. He says, you know, when the Roman Empire fell and the church was attacked in the West and fell there, the church in the East, the Catholic Church in the East was still strong. That was Justinian and whatever. Then, when the East fell in 553, in 1453, when the Eastern Roman Empire fell, again, the West was again strong. So Rome has two legs, and the two legs have never been fallen. That was his view. So the dual interpretation also of the little horn. The little horn is Antiochus Epiphanes. He is a type of the Antichrist, and the true Antichrist will appear in the future. So that is how he diverted the attention of the Protestants. Now another interpretation, also by the Jesuits, and that was modern preterism. Louis Diaz Alcazar, he wrote a nearly 1,000-page book in Latin, and the focus is the identification of the Antichrist in the book of Revelation. His identification is the context of the book of Revelation. It is a war of the Catholic Church on the Jews and the pagans. Revelation 1 through 11 is the rejection of the Jews, the fall of Jerusalem. And Revelation 12 through 19 is the overthrow of pagan Roman Empire. Sources again, the early church fathers, because there were some early church fathers who saw the Antichrist as one of the Roman emperors. And so the view of Antichrist? Antichrist has already appeared. Antichrist is not a system, but is Emperor Nero. So here you have two systems that conflict, but the Jesuit says it doesn't matter, as long as we get rid of the Protestants and the views. You see, I mean, they are not after truth, because if one system is truth, the other one should be false. And so here then, you find those two views were introduced. Now, what was the impact on Protestantism? In the beginning, in the 16th and 17th century, and the 18th century, very little. Short version, a short-term effect on the Protestants was minimal. Few Protestants accepted futurism or preterism. Long-term effect was extensive. You have to go to the 19th century and the 20th century when you get the impact also of higher criticism and historical criticism. Futurism was then adopted later on and now also today by the evangelicals and dispensationalists. And preterism was adopted by the historical critics. Here you have Scofield's Bible, where you find a dispensationalism in this. Now, after the Christian churches rejected the great Second Advent movement of the 1840s that was based on the Protestant historicist method of prophetic interpretation, these Protestants accepted the futurist interpretation and the preterist interpretation of the Counter-Reformation, because people did not see the problem, did not see the solution to the problems in the 19th century in regard to the interpretation of Daniel Revelation. They had to accept something else. Now only a few Christians accept the historicist. The large majority now follows the Roman Catholic approach to prophecy, bringing Catholics and Protestants closer together in the prophetic understanding. And that is and if you are familiar with the history of Protestantism, I'm presently writing a whole book on the development of prophetic interpretation, and it becomes very, very clear the shift that has taken place in the 19th century and the approach of Catholics and Protestants today. However, before we continue, let us just look here at a new kind of Protestantism in the 17th and 18th century. The focus was then during that time on the reformers and not on the Bible. They were engaged in theological controversies. What did Luther say? What did Calvin say? Instead of going to the Bible and say, maybe there is more truth to what Luther and Calvin and Knox discovered. And so it was a whole controversy between denominations. The Lutherans fought with the Reformed, and the Reformed with the Lutherans, and all those kind of things. The churches were using government power to suppress views different from those of the Reformers. Development of a cult orthodoxy of the Sardis Church, the fifth church in the book of Revelation, and it appears to be alive, but is death. Revelation 3, verse 1. And you get here a whole stagnation of the Protestant Reformation. So what did the Lord now do? Here's an interesting thought that a number of Protestant writers came up with. Jesus' strategy for the last days. The Protestant Reformation is to continue. Many believe that we need to continue with the Reformation. Here in the book Early Writings by Ellen White, she says, Jesus and all the heavenly hosts looked with disgust upon the scene there, yet God had a message for the church that was sacred and important. If received, it would make a thorough reformation in the church, revive the living testimony that would purge out hypocrites and sinners and bring the church again into favor with God. And so what is now Jesus' strategy? Here, through signs in the times. Jesus' strategy reveals in prophecy. Signs on earth, sun, moon, and stars. God has given us three major signs. That is the earthquake of Lisbon, the greatest ever struck the earth in 1755. Then the dark day in the Western Hemisphere of 1780. And then the falling of the stars, the great meteoric shower in 1833, where 60,000 falling stars per hour took place. And Christians and Protestants at that time identified this as the fulfillment of Revelation 6, the three great signs before the coming of Christ. Then you have the French Revolution that God used to bring the deadly wound in the papacy in 1798. Then from 1798 on, there began an unsealing of the book of Daniel in chapter 12, verse 4. that shifted the attention from the 1260 prophetic days of Daniel 7, because that was now solved, to the 2300 prophetic days of Revelation 8. And the result was the study of Daniel 8:14 resulted in the rise of the great Second Advent movement in the 1830s and 1840s. So what was now the general Protestant view of Daniel 8? Here is the period, and every denomination was involved. Even in Holland, my country, where I looked and saw that there was one Dutchman, the curator of the Royal Dutch Museum, who wrote 20 tracts about this prophecy. Position of about 100 non-Millerite Adventist interpreters. Here is their view on the end of that period, the beginning of the millennium on earth. Did the millennium begin? No. The fall of the destruction of Mohammedanism, the Islam, in 1844, did it? No. Cleansing of the Jerusalem and restoration of true worship, did it take? No. Again, the re-establishment on the conversion of the Jews in Palestine? No. Cleansing of the church of the Antichrist into other nations? No. Cleansing of the church from all impurities? No. Purging of the church from all papal influences? No. Re-establishment of the true worship of God? No. So everyone experienced a disappointment in the 1840s. All experienced a disappointment, including the Adventist, who predicted that Jesus would come. So, let us now look here what the Adventists thought. William Miller and the Bible only. Here he is. And let me tell you that this is one of the best understandings. He summarized basically all the Protestant views about how to interpret the Bible. Sola Scriptura principles of the Adventist Bible interpretation that were Reformed principles that he systematized in 13 points. First, all scripture is necessary and may be understood by diligent application of Bible study. So, the Bible and the Bible only. Every word must have its proper influence on the subject presented in the Bible. Again, the Bible. Scripture must be its own interpreter, since it is a rule of itself. If I depend on a teacher to expound it to me, and he should guess at its meaning, or desire to have it so on account of his sectarian creed, or thought wise, then his guessing, desire, creed, and wisdom is my guide, not the Bible. See? So again, the Bible is the answer. You don't need to read a whole book how to interpret the Bible. No, you go to the Bible and find it out yourself. To understand the doctrine, bring all the scriptures together on the subject you wish to know, then let every word have its proper influence, and if you can form your theory without a contradiction, you cannot be in error. Friends, if Protestants had followed this principle, there would not be such a conflagration, so confusion among the many, many churches. No matter what, this is the key. And we have an important person, Ellen White, who says, those who are engaged in proclaiming the third angel's message are searching the scriptures upon the same plan that Father Miller adopted. Ellen White, Rice, Review and Herald, November 25, 1846. She is fully behind the Protestant view of how to interpret the Bible. And she says, our church is based on that one. So, what about prophetic interpretation? God has revealed things to come by vision, in figure, parables, and in this way, the same things are often revealed again and again by different visions or different figures or parables. And if you wish to understand them, you must combine them all together. Visions are always mentioned as such. If you know when a word is figuratively used or symbolically, if it makes good sense as it stands and does no violence to the simple law of nature, then it must be understood literally, if not figuratively. So if you see a beast with four heads, of course it is not literally, figuratively. So that is simple law. Figures have always a figurative meaning and are used much in prophetic prophecy to represent future things, times, events such as mountains, meaning governments, beasts, meaning kingdoms, waters, meaning people, lambs, meaning the word of God, days, meaning a year. And so to learn the true meaning of figures, trace your figures, words, through your Bible. And when you can find it explained, put it on your figure. And if it makes good sense, you don't need to go further. And so figures are sometimes have two or three meanings. As a day is used in a figurative sense. It represents three different meanings, three periods of time. Indefinite, definite, a day for a year, and a day for 1,000 years. So a literal day, a day for a year, and you have to look and study it. Parables are used as comparisons to illustrate subjects and must be explained in the same way as symbols by subject of Bible. And so here then, this is the key. To know whether we have the true historical event for the fulfillment of prophecy, if you find every word of the prophecy after the figures are understood is literally fulfilled, then you may know that your history is the true event. But if one word lacks a fulfillment, then you must look for another event and wait for future development. For God takes care that history and prophecy does agree, so that the true believing children of God may never be ashamed. And so here then, the last one, the most important rule of it all is that you must have faith. It must be a faith that requires sacrifice, and if tried, would give up the dearest subject on earth, the world and all its desires, character, living occupation, friends, home, comfort, and worldly honors. If any one of those should hinder our believing any part of God's word, it would show our faith to be in vain. Nor can we ever believe so long as one of these motives be lurking in our hearts. We must believe that God will never forfeit his word. See, that is then the key. And the source is what you found in my book, Foundations of the Seventh-day Adventist Message and Mission, which you can order through Andrews University, or you find it also on the Ellen White CD-ROM, the digital one. So William Miller view of the Daniel 8, the little horn, Rome, pagan and papal, sanctuary, the earth, and the cleansing of the sanctuary, the event, the cleansing of the earth, Jesus begins, the judgment, second advent, and that is what it is. And as a result came the first angel's message, Revelation 14, verse 6 and 7, which deals with the hour of his judgment. And then when they proclaim this, go tell it to the world, that is how the Adventist Church and its message started. And note the impact of Protestant Reformation on Adventism. Adventist inherited the historical interpretation of prophecy. At the same time, they inherited the view that the papacy is the Antichrist and the man of sin and the little horn of Daniel out of rose of the enterprise. Here they inherited the Year Day principle, and the Adventist commitment to the Bible and the Bible only separated them from opposing Christians who refused to new light on Christ.